Hi there, and welcome to The Daily Gardener, a podcast about gardening, botanical history, and literature. I'm your host, Jennifer Ebling, and today is November 1st. Today in botanical history, we celebrate a wealthy gardener and apothecary whose garden became his legacy. We'll also remember a pioneering landscape architect who left his mark on the world in his all-too-short life. And then we'll take a look at the fun that can be had dyeing flowers. We'll hear an excerpt from a book by a Quaker woman who spent a year tending sheep. And we grow that garden library today with a book about flowers in all their glory. And the book takes us inside the secret world of plants. And then we'll wrap things up with a little poem that was written by an American writer. And it's a little poignant, by the way. So Kleenex should be on standby. Well, before we get to all of that, I wanted to begin today's show with this quote by Dorothy Dunnett. This quote is from one of the books in her legendary Lymond Chronicles. It's from Book 6, and it's called Checkmate. Now, Checkmate takes place in 1557, and the plot is that Francis Crawford of Lymond is once again in France, and he's leading an army against England. Now, Francis is Scottish. He's an adventurer. And even though he is masterful on the battlefield, he is haunted by his past. And this excerpt begins this way. If you're the 1st of November, you're Scorpio, a large reporter of his own acts, prudent of behavior in own affairs, a lover of quarrels and thievery, a promoter of frayes and commotions, as wavery as the wind, neither fearing God or caring for man. Better, said Lymond coldly, to be stung by a nettle than pricked by a rose. Kind of a fun little way to start November. And speaking of kicking off November, I always think about Maggie Dietz and her poem called November, this time of year. It starts out marvelously this way. Show's over, folks, and didn't October do a bang-up job? And then Maggie talks about all of the beauty of the month of October. She writes, crisp breezes, full-throated cries of migrating geese, low-floating coral moon. Nothing's left but fool's gold in the trees. And then this is the point where Maggie looks back and with a little pang of regret, she asks, did I love it enough? The full throttle foliage while it lasted, was I dazzled? Did you spend enough time admiring the beauty of autumn this year? She continues, the bees have up and quit their last ditch flights of forage and gone to shiver in their winter clusters. Field mice hit the barns. Big squirrels gorge on busted chestnuts. A sky like hardened plaster hovers. The pasty river, its next of kin, coughs up reed grass, fat as feather dusters. And then this is the point where she talks about how the kids come back indoors and they do what they like to do, which is play video games. She writes, even the swarms of kids have given in to winter's big excuse, boxed-in allure. TVs ricochet light behind pulled curtains. And then finally, she wraps things up by talking about how the days are getting shorter and it gets dark earlier. And maybe you, like me, have been noticing that and commenting on it. Maggie writes, the days throw up a closed sign around 4. And the hapless customer who'd wanted something arrives to find lights out, a bolted door. So there you go. We are heading into winter and there's no bones about it. Here in Minnesota, we woke up to really cold temperatures in the high 20s. after Sunday. So Halloween came and went, and winter knocked on our door instead. He was the next up in the trick-or-treat line. And so here we are with winter making its way into our gardens. You know, this day, November 1st, as I was looking back through all types of garden literature, has been traditionally a pretty big day for garden publishers. In 1995, Rosemary Veery's Making of a Garden was published on this day. And also a really good book that I ran across recently called The Unsung Season was also published on the same day as Rosemary Veery's book, but to much less acclaim, of course. But I wanted to highlight it briefly. It's called, again, The Unsung Season, Gardens and Gardeners in Winter. And it was written by Sydney Edison and Karen Busolini. And this particular book you can find on Amazon. I'll put a link to it in today's show notes. But I want to say you can get a copy for under a dollar. And it is really marvelous. It's a wonderful book on gardens in winter and gardeners in winter, what it's like to experience that. And so, marvelous title, The Unsung Season. So keep that in mind. Also, in 2001, there was a really good book, garden book. It was written by James Fenton. It was published on this day, and it was called A Garden from 100 Packets of Seed. Great title. And so the premise behind this book is, what plants would you choose to grow if you were given a blank slate of a garden and given one rule that everything you grow in this garden, you have to raise, you have to cultivate from seed, from planting seeds. So great premise, fun little book there. And then finally, another great book that was published on this day in 2009 that's definitely worth your attention is all about Jane Colden, America's first woman botanist. And that book was written by Paula Ivaska Robbins. So fantastic book. That's definitely one that you want in your botanical library. They're all very good. So definitely check those out. I'll put links to all of them in today's show notes. So if you want to check them out, you can do that there. I'll also throw them in the Facebook group to try to make it really easy for you. And again, as per usual, any of those links that you click on are Amazon links. They're affiliate links that help support the show. So if you're going to get them, please make sure to use the links, and then that way you can help support the Daily Gardener podcast as well. All right, it's time for today's curated news. Oh, I loved today's curated news. This was actually a YouTube video that I stumbled on. I was researching a Southern writer, a woman named Lee Smith, marvelous woman. Today's her birthday. She was born in 1944, and she did an interview for the Southern Environmental Law Center. And I ended up watching this little clip, and it was so entertaining and so good that I wanted to share it with you. So I put the clip in the Facebook group for the show. So if you want to check it out for yourself, just head on over to the Facebook group, type in the word Lee or Smith, and this video will pop up. But what was fascinating to me about this video, number one, she has a delightful accent. So if you're from the South, you may find her voice and her accent to be utterly charming and soothing. I know I did. And I was thinking about some of my Southern friends as I was listening to Lee. She's very, very, very soft-spoken, very mild-mannered woman, and just wonderful to listen to. Anyway, in the video, what Lee talks about is how the South has this very strong literary tradition that is grounded in place, that is grounded in the setting. And of course, the setting for so many Southern writers is usually a rural place, is a place that is wild and that is truly bound up in nature. Lee says that the land is so important to Southern writing, and that it not only shows up in writing, but also in Southern music and Southern culture. So you'll notice it there. And if you haven't noticed that before, then tuck that little nugget away. And as you encounter it, you'll say, ah, Lee Smith, she was right again. Well, one of the most absolutely charming things that Lee talks about in this video, aside from her love of nature and gardens and all of that, is a little snippet that she shares about her dad. And apparently, as her dad was growing older, she was trying to get him to leave the family home that was up in the mountains. And she wanted him to come and live with her in her home in North Carolina. And she recalled how he would always say, I can't leave the mountains. I just can't do it. He said, I need me a mountain to rest my eyes against. And that really resonated with me because I immediately thought of gardeners. And I thought about how we need us a garden to rest our eyes against. Well, that saying definitely had an impact on Lee, on the importance of natural places. And so as she was thinking about nature and what she wanted to say in this interview with Southern Environmental Law Center, that saying came back to her. And that's what she talked about. I need me a mountain to rest my eyes against. And so she ends her interview by saying how nature leads us to think of things that are really important, to ponder big questions and issues and all of the things that we need to be working on. And so Lee, like us, draws her inspiration from the natural world. And so once again, to borrow her phrase, I need me a garden to rest my eyes against. Great little saying. All right, it's time for today's botanical history. Here's botanical history for today, November 1st. Today is the birthday of James Sherard. He was the English apothecary, botanist, amateur musician, and composer. And he was born on this day, November 1st, in 1666. His older brother, William, by the way, was also a botanist. So if you recognize the name, there were two boys in the Sherard family that became botanists. Now, James served as an apprentice to an apothecary named Charles Watts, who happened to work at the Chelsea Physic Garden. And then after that experience as an apprentice, James followed his entrepreneurial instincts, and he started his own business, which made him very wealthy. But all of that wealth, you can imagine, got spent, at least a good deal of it, on plants. And in August of 1716, James wrote that, quote, the love of botany has so far prevailed as to divert my mind from things I formerly thought more material. And one of the passions that he used to have before botany was writing and composing music. He was really into that. But then he had a flare-up of gout, and that pain led him away from pursuing music, and he ended up turning his attention to botany. Well, after making money in his business, he ends up retiring, and James purchased three residences. He bought two manor houses and a place in London, and it was at his London residence that he established a garden, and he began collecting and cultivating rare plants. Now, around the time that James's garden was being recognized as one of England's top gardens, James's older brother, Will, the botanist, invited a German botanist named Johann Delinius to visit them in England. And while he was there, Delinius ends up creating an illustrated catalog that described all of the plants that were cultivated in James's London garden. Can you imagine having a famous botanist come to your garden and then putting together a beautiful inventory of your plants? Well, that's essentially what happened here. Now, the English botanical writer Blanche Henry said this about Delinius's book. It's the most important book published in England during the 18th century on plants growing in a private garden. Well, interestingly enough, I found this amazing factoid on Twitter. It turns out that the walls of the herbarium room at the Oxford Botanic Garden and Arboretum are graced with illustrations from Delinius's book. It's all plants. Plants from James Sherard's beautiful garden. And so his gorgeous garden lives on in the walls of that marvelous place. And today is also the birthday of an American landscape architect who did incredible things during his all-too-short life. And of course, I'm talking about Charles Eliot. He was born on this day in 1859. In his very brief career, Charles established principles for regional planning and naturalistic systems for landscape architecture. And he also helped to set up the world's first land trust and the Boston Metropolitan Park System. Charles was a prolific writer and an observer of nature and landscapes, and his work ended up setting the stage for conservancies across the world. So he made a huge impact on the way we regard our natural spaces and our environment. Charles was born into a prominent Boston family. In 1869, the year that his mother died, his father, Charles Sr., Charles William Eliot, became the president of Harvard University. In 1882, when Charles came of age, he went to Harvard to study botany. And a year later, he began apprenticing with the landscape firm of Frederick Law Olmsted. And eventually, that firm became known for a brief while as Olmsted and Eliot. And it was because of Charles Eliot. But when he was starting out as a young landscape architect, Charles enjoyed visiting natural areas, and he conducted regular walking tours, kind of like Henry David Thoreau, of different nature areas around Boston. And in one of his diaries, Charles made a charming list, and I've always thought that it was just so poignant. It said this: a partial list of Saturday walks before 1878. Isn't that fantastic? So if you've never kept a diary of your walks or where you've gone, just for posterity, for future generations, you might want to consider doing that. Well, Charles, in his early career, spent 13 months. He got to be in Europe and England for over a year between 1885 and 1886. And this trip was actually Olmsted's idea, and it became a marvelous experience for Charles, for his understanding of various landscape concepts, and for his overall training. Now, during this trip, Charles keeps a diary, of course, and he wrote down his thoughts and made sketches, beautiful sketches, of the places that he visited. During his time in Europe, his benchmark was always Boston, his hometown. So throughout his writings, Charles was continually comparing new landscapes to the beauty of his native landscape back in New England. Well, Charles' story, as I've alluded to now many times, ended way too soon. He died at 37 from spinal meningitis. But before his death, Charles had worked with Charles Sprague Sargent at the Arnold Arboretum. He was helping to put together a plan there. And when Charles died, It was Sargent who wrote a tribute to him, and he featured it in his weekly journal at Harvard called Garden and Forest, and you can read it online today. Charles's death had a significant impact on his dad, Charles Eliot Sr. At times when Charles was alive, the two men had struggled to connect. Charles didn't like it when his dad had remarried, and their personalities were very different, and so that made it difficult for the two of them to connect. In addition to that, Charles, the architect, the son, could be a little melancholy. Well, after Charles died, his dad, Charles Sr., started culling through his son's work, and in April of 1897, Charles Sr. wrote to a friend, "I'm examining his letters and papers, and I am filled with wonder at what he accomplished in the 10 years of professional life. I should have died without ever appreciating his influence, but his death has shown it to me." Well, despite his heavy workload as the president of Harvard, Charles Sr. immediately set about compiling all of his son's work, organizing it, and he used it to write a book called Charles Eliot, Landscape Architect. The book came out in 1902, so almost 120 years ago, and today it is considered a classic work in the field of landscape architecture. And it's definitely on my wish list for Christmas this year. Well, it was also on this day in 1883, November 1st, that the Brown County World out of Hiawatha, Kansas, published just a little blurb, and it said this: "A distinguished botanist has found that by simply soaking the stems of cut flowers in a weak dye solution, their colors can be altered at will without the perfume and freshness being destroyed." Well, this is true. Flowers can absorb food coloring, and it's important to know that if you're going to try this, make sure to do it with herbaceous plants that don't have woody stems. So think about plants that die back to the ground at the end of their growing season. They can be perennial, biennial, or even annuals. Your annuals will work for this. And they work particularly well because of their quick growth and the shorter flowering period. But plants that you want to consider using if you're going to attempt something like this might be something that it has a white blossom. They tend to work really well for this. So think of Queen Anne's lace, hydrangea, daisy, and carnations. Carnations are probably the most widely used for this purpose. So sometimes if you're in the supermarket, you'll even see the carnations that are blue or some other strange color. And that's because they're dyeing them. They're putting a little dye in the water, and then the plant is taking that up. So there you go. A little helpful blurb from the Brown County World in Hiawatha, Kansas, back in 1883. It's time for today's Unearthed Words. Today's Unearthed Words come to us from Mary Rose O'Reilly. She is a Quaker woman that decided to take a year out of her life and spend time herding sheep. And then she wrote about that experience in a book called The Barn at the End of the World, The Apprenticeship of a Quaker Buddhist Shepherd. I kid you not, that's what it's called. Anyway, here is a marvelous excerpt from that book. And I picked it because she is writing about her first day of November during that experience. So here's what she wrote. "On the first day of November last year, sacred to many religious calendars, but especially the Celtic, I went for a walk among bare oaks and birch. Nothing much was going on. scarlet sumac had passed and the bees were dead. The pond had slicked overnight into that shiny and deceptive glaze of delusion. First ice. It made me remember skates and conjure a vision of myself skimming backward on one foot and the other extended, the arms become wings. Minnesota girls know that this is not a difficult maneuver if one's limber and practices even a little after school before the boys can claim the rink for hockey. I think I can still do it. One thinks many foolish things when November's bright sun skips over the entrancing first freeze. A flock of sparrows reels through the air, looking more like a flying net than 70 conscious birds, a black veil thrown on the wind. When one sparrow dodges, the whole net swerves, dips. One mind. Am I part of anything like that? Maybe not. It's an ugly woods, I was saying to myself, padding along a trail where other walkers had broken ground before me. And then I found an extraordinary bouquet. Someone had bound an offering of dry seed pods, yew, lyme grass, red berries, and brown fern, and laid it on the path. Nothing special, as Buddhists say, meaning everything. Gathered to formality, each dry stalk proclaimed a slant, an attitude, infinite shades of neutral. All contemplative acts, silences, poems, honor the world this way, brought together by the eye of love, a milkweed pod, a twig. Allow us to see how things have been all along. A feast of being. It's time to grow that garden library with today's book, Flora by DK. And it was also contributed to by Q, the Royal Botanic Gardens. This book was published back in 2018, and the subtitle is Inside the Secret World of Plants. Well, let me tell you that when I got my copy of this book, I was so pleasantly surprised. This is a big book. It's a coffee table book. The cover is predominantly white, and then it just has a single flower on the cover, and it is stunning. This is a fantastic book. I think of it like a floral scrapbook. So imagine if you were to put together a book of flowers, and on each page, you feature a different blossom. You talk about the plant and you talk about its history and some outstanding characteristics. And then you talk about various aspects of the plant. You get into a little bit of the science behind why plants do what they do and how they do what they do. And you have this book. It's beautifully illustrated with modern photography and also some incredibly beautiful botanical art from the ages. And it is just a joy to leaf through. So whether you are a gardener or even a non-gardener, I think you would enjoy this book. And because it's been out now for a while, you can get a used copy of this book and support the show for under $12 right now. But if you're interested, you better act fast because there are not many copies at that price. Don't forget that you can support the show using the link in today's show notes. Finally, here's something sweet to revive the little botanic spark in your heart. It was on this day, November 1st in 1871, that Stephen Crane, the American poet, novelist, and short story writer, was born. Stephen started writing at the tender age of 4. And as a young adult, he dropped out of college at Syracuse and started working as a reporter and writer. By 1895, his Civil War novel, The Red Badge of Courage, won acclaim, despite Stephen never having any personal experience as a soldier. The following year, Stephen was asked to go to Cuba as a war correspondent. But during the voyage, his ship, the SS Commodore, sank off the coast of Florida. Stephen survived after spending 30 hours adrift at sea in a small dinghy along with other survivors. The experience became the basis for his next book called The Open Boat. Well, despite surviving the shipwreck, Stephen Crane tragically died young of tuberculosis at the age of 28. Today, The Red Badge of Courage is considered an American classic. But Stephen also wrote short stories and poetry, and one of his biggest fans happened to be Ernest Hemingway, who credited Stephen as a source of his inspiration. Today, I selected Stephen's poem, The Black Riders and Other Lines, something he wrote in 1895. And I thought the last lines of this verse were particularly poignant for gardeners. Stephen wrote, "There was set before me a mighty hill, and long days I climbed through regions of snow. When I had before me the summit view, it seemed that my labor had been to see gardens lying at impossible distances." Thanks for listening to The Daily Gardener. And remember, for a happy, healthy life, garden every day. The Daily Gardener is produced in lovely Maple Grove in Wyoming, Minnesota. If you want to read today's show notes, just head on over to thedailygardener.org. And while you're there, be sure to sign up for my free Friday newsletter. And don't forget that you have a standing invitation to join the free Facebook group for listeners of the show. Just search for Daily Gardener Community the next time you're on Facebook and request to join. Last but not least, you can always get in touch by emailing me at jennifer@thedailygardener.org. I'm your host, Jennifer Ebling, and as always, have a great day in the garden, and we'll see you tomorrow.